Hello, everybody. My name is Daniel Richardson, and I'm the WCPW Review Guy. And before I get started today, I just want to give a quick shout-out to everybody out there who's competing for the Commons Champion. Anybody out there who's scratching their head wondering what the hell the Commons Champion is? I don't know. Months ago, I would have people, you know, it's like the YouTube thing where a video comes on, and you're like, first, I'm the first one to get it in there, comment. And so I used to just kind of, I'd roll with it, and I'd be like, well, yeah. Hey, your trophy's in the mail, blah, blah, blah. But then, you know, people kept doing it, so I was just like, I started upgrading. And I was like, well, I ran out of trophies, but, you know, your check's in the mail, you know, whatever the case may be. But then I was like, well, this is a wrestling channel. So I started handing out the fictitious champion or comments champion. You know, first person to comment, you're the new champion. But, like, it caught on, and, like, people are literally like, I can always count on at least 4 or 5 views because everybody's going to try to jump in there on one, you know, at least once just to capture the bell. Jonathan and Emma's channel, Isaac Slater, Tilly Lloyd, there's a few others. You guys rock. And that's awesome right there. I just think that's really cool. So, but it's funny because, I mean, it literally is like you'll get, I mean, there's been times where I had 3 or 4 people comment like at once almost. I'm like, holy shit, like people are actually doing this. This is insane. So there you go, the prestigious comments title. It's out there, it's circulating. Comment first and try to get the title yourself. And this is the WCPW Hendry Mania review. And I'm not gonna lie, I'm not trying to burn you guys with this. It's just been a crazy weekend, and I'm just trying to cram everything in here at once. So, like literally up at a ridiculous hour last night or this morning, watching Hendry Mania, making sure I get it in, get my review up in time. Let's get right into it. I will say this right off the bat: we're in Hendry's hometown. It seems like, and I'm not sure if it's just the venue or what, because it looked like a pretty good-sized room, but it was like they just filled one side, which makes sense. I mean, if it's a taping, you know, fuck the back side, which, you know, but it seemed like even the front side seemed a little, I don't know, not as crowded. Like, almost, it's kind of a small crowd, and it was just kind of emphasized more by the big room or whatever. Which, still yet, I mean, let's remember way back in the day when there was only, like, 10 people in the audience. WCPW doesn't help put on a good show anyways. They'll entertain regardless. But this little thing I just got in the notice right there. And I guess I should go ahead and mention right off the top of the hour that I guess there was 3 no-shows last night due to weather conditions. Dave Mastiff, Scott Wainwright, and I think they said a guy named Mike Davis, if I'm mistaken there. But apparently none of them can make it. Scott Wainwright is, of course, going to be a part of that hardcore match. He's going to make a triple threat, but then they just went and made a singles hardcore match. And Dave Mastiff was supposed to fight El Ligero. There were a few because he ripped the horn off and everything, all that stuff. They were going to try to settle that, but that didn't work. And I'm just guessing Mike Davis is fighting Mike Bailey because they ended up just throwing Ligero and Bailey together. So they didn't make it tonight. So Hendry comes out to a decent-sized pop. You know, he is the heel, but I mean, it is his hometown. But it's funny as he does the shushing, and it works. Like, it's almost fucking silent when he gets out there. And I was just like, oh. And it's just funny because he's like, you can tell he's trying to generate some booze so he can shush him. Like, no, they're just like, no, we hear you. We want to listen to what you guys say. The shushing works, and then it's just like, ah. Like, he ain't getting much heat from the crowd at all. Like, I don't know. They don't want to boo the hometown. Not until later, anyways. Later on, he gets the booze. But, like, right off the bat, right here, at least when he's out here by himself, no booze to be had. Of course, he's going on with this whole, he's in charge. You know, there's no general manager. And, curious to see how this works right here. He announces that, because Bradshaw's the only one that's out there on commentary right now. And then, of course, he announces that it was going to be James R. Kennedy taking the spot. And I want to go ahead and mention this right now. Really enjoyed the commentary on this edition of Hendry Mania. I think James R. Kennedy does a really good job at commentating, and I would like to see him come back as well. Like, literally, we got a great group of gifted commentators. Like, seriously. Stryker, Bennett, Bradshaw, Shane, Kennedy. I mean, that's a fucking awesome group right there. And it's becoming to the point where now I don't mind them trading out as much. Like, even though, and I will, till the day I die, till there's no more breath within these lungs, I'm going to say Bradshaw and Shane's my favorite team. But with that being said, I think when you switch it up like this, it's not a bad thing. I thought Tick Kennedy did a really good job. I thought a lot of stuff he was saying was really funny. I was retweeting some of the shit he was saying. I thought this was great. He did a really good job, so I'm really digging that. Hendry brings out Adam Cleary. Apparently, there's no other Adams back there, so we get the third-rate Adam. He comes out there, and of course, he's like, you know, you're in charge here at Walk Culture. You're one of the guys in charge of, you know, putting the show together. And he's like, where's my streamers? Where's my balloons? You know, because Kirby Mania was a big celebration, and this one wasn't. This, in fact, I really liked their the way they kind of had it set up, because you just had these spotlights in the ring, but it gave it a very cold, uncelebratory feel, and I like that, because I mean, it is like, you know, we're not celebrating. Fuck the prestige, you know, you're not supposed to like these guys, even though I do. But no, you're supposed to have like this kind of like anti-celebration feel. So I really like that. But then of course, when Cleary gets out there, he puts his belt down. It's like, come on, Cleary, you really getting in the ring? Like, what is it with these Adams thinking they can get in the ring and do anything? Like, seriously. Blompier is just like, I'll get in there, I'll trust you, no funny business. And then he gets, you know, freaking natured. Pachidi's constantly trying to wrestle, getting his ass handed to him in a rumble. And then Cleary's just like, yeah, I'll walk in here. After seeing this guy attack the general manager, I'm not even the general manager, I'm going to get in here because I trust this guy. And he got himself bitch slapped for his effort, and then he walked away, probably crying to himself. So yeah, Joe Hendry. I will say this is an overall kind of observation. We're live. Overall observation of the evening, I really wish I would have seen more maybe skits backstage, or even Hendry interjecting himself, or other prestige members interjecting themselves throughout the night. Every time there was a This Is Awesome chant, I was really hoping he'd come out and be like, no, this is my show, I don't like that shit, and don't quit chant. Just something. I just felt like, I don't know, they had so many missed opportunities to do really cool things to make this just kind of feel like Hendry's just being a complete asshole, and they just didn't do any of it. And I was really kind of disappointed by that. But that said, let's get on to the actual show, shall we? Of course, first match, we got Drake versus Shaw Samuels. And yeah, this match, now once again, I always do my favorite match and I do my least favorite match. And this match was a fine match, but there wasn't a whole lot to it. And unfortunately, this will be my least favorite, or my eighth ranked match. That sounds nicer. But no, this match was still fun. And I love the ending, because I just assumed Samuels was just going to get the squash win here. No pun intended, because he's kind of a big guy. But no, I thought, I know, honestly, he was just going to dominate. Drake, however, he removes the turnbuckle pad, and as the referee's trying to put it back on, he grabs a wrench and just clocks Samuels with it. 1, 2, 3, Drake wins. Drake needs more wins. Like, I kind of get it. Like, he is kind of like that. He's a jobber at times, you know, but I just like the guy. And after seeing him do some interviews with Simon Miller, he just seems like a really cool guy. So I just want him to succeed so much. So I don't care if he has to crack people with wrenches from here on out. I approve. But no, Drake wins, picks up the win. So way to go, Drake. Up next, we got a tag team match. It's a Kid Fight and Luke King Sharp. Haven't seen them in a while. Going up against Prospect. We get some technical difficulties. Not as bad as some of the stuff that I didn't mention this on the Canadian qualifier thing, but they kept having this camera glitch thing. Here we get the wrestlers, the wrong music hits, and then the video comes up, and then they switched. It's just a very long delay, and you're just like, oh. And of course, Bradshaw does try to say, he's like, maybe this is mind games. I'm like, no, it's just technical difficulties. Like, they're messing up back there. So this match comes up there, and once again, I know I seem to contradict myself a lot. And I'll probably still do it. There are times when I'm anti-comedy, and then there's times I'm for comedy. And like, this match had some comedy, and I liked it. Like, maybe it's because it's Prospect, and I love Prospect. But I just loved a lot of stuff here. At one point, like, Sean McLaughlin gives, I think it was Sharp, the Bronco Buster. No, it was a Fight, Kid Fight. He gives him the Bronco. Like, everybody does a Bronco Buster, and then he throws him into him. He does a Bronco Buster, and then they end up throwing Sharp into Fight. And I was just like, that's just funny stuff. Like, I don't know. Normally, I hate when the referees get involved like that, but at the same time, it put a smile on my face. So I was like, we're good with that. The action itself was pretty good. And I just loved, they did that whole, like, they did this little dabbing showdown at the very beginning. I just love, like, Luke King Sharp, like, loses his shit, just starts freaking out, dabbing like a madman. And even, like, you know, Kid Fight, like, goes over on the other side of Prospect and just looks at him like, what the fuck? I don't know. It was funny stuff. We get some really good tag team action here, though, when you get past the comedy stuff, even. One of my favorite little moments here was, and this was still as comedy, but Luke King Sharp puts his foot up, you know, on the turnbuckle. I can't get my foot up that high. So that, you know, Kid Fight can bash, you know, I think it's Archer's head into the boot. Of course, he does. However, the Force knocks Liu Kang Sharp just right off the apron, and you're like, oh, little guy. He might be like a Paul Robinson. I didn't realize Liu Kang Sharp was that short, because I've only seen him, you know, once or twice. And I was just like, oh, wow, like, he's really small. He's a little tiny guy. He's like me. I'm small. I'm short. So, I mean, it's just like, all right. Nice to see a short guy get in there and try to get some work. I appreciate it. You know, at one point, I thought it was kind of a cool move. I think it was Archer was in the corner, and Kid Fight picks up Sharp, like a powerbomb, just like launches him into it. I thought that was kind of cool. And then, of course, the match, however, comes to an end. They keep working over Archer's knee. And that, it's been done for a while now, and it seems like I've been noticing it more and more. And even last night, before this becomes anything, I was just like, well, Archer's knee's going out again. It just reminded me of like Bret Hart, like in 93, 94. Like, there was a time where, like, his knee just went out in every match. Like, that was just the driving thing. Like, how is Hart making it? You know, his knee's out. And he'd always win regardless. But still, like, the knee was always taken out, like, in every single match. So I just remember kind of jokingly was, you know, making a mental note of that. Gracie gets in, House of Fire, and hits Liu Kang Sharp with the Unprettier. 1-2-3. Prospect picks up an awesome win. However, after the match, you know, Archer's in the ring. He's on his butt. He, you know, asks for a microphone. And I just love that, you know, the Kennedy. Like, during the commentary, Drake, because that's, you know, that's his guy too, that's his client, but then with Prospect as well, like, he just adds so much more, I guess, dimension to the commentating team, because I guess, because, you know, he was a manager as well, he's a manager for the other former manager in the case of Prospect, but I just love the fact, like, just listen to Kenny, because, I mean, this promo was awesome. I'm not gonna lie, I even got a little emotional, if you will, maybe a little choked up, maybe a tiny bit, but Archer says that, you know, he's, you know, his knee's not healing up on him, and he's going to have to take at least a year off. And he starts the whole thing off by saying, you know, Gracie's his best friend. And I'm like, wow. It got kind of real there for a second. But then here's the odd thing. Like, don't get me wrong. I'm not taking that away from promo. The promo was incredible. But then Gracie's like, we're not going to end it like this. And he's like, I entered us into the, they got a gauntlet to become the number one contender for the tag titles. And I think it's that Fight Back, I believe. But he's like, I entered us into that. And I was like, hey, you didn't listen to the way that. He literally just said his knee is, like, fucked up. Like, he can't wrestle. And, of course, I'm just like, it kind of blew my mind that, like, Gracie, don't get me wrong, I mean, I understand where Gracie's coming from, but it's just kind of like, yeah, but he just, that'd be like, I don't know. Like, when I do my other show and, like, Steve is just like, hey, I can't make it. Like, you know, I'm in the hospital bed. I'm, you know, paralyzed right now. I'm like, we're still going to do the show. Like, don't worry about it, buddy. We're going to move forward together. It's like, no, he clearly needs hospital rest. And I'm just thinking, like, you know, Archer literally put his heart out there and just like, I can't. It's a hard decision to make. I can't move on. I'm going to have to think about, you know, not just me, but my family. I got to take some time off. You know, sorry, it's going to take over a year to heal this knee. And Gracie's like, nah, we got another match in another month. Don't worry about it. You're going to be fine. And I was like, holy shit. But yeah, really, it was like really an emotional moment. But the fact that, like, Kennedy was just undercutting it, just being, you know, an asshole, I even love more, because it just seemed like it's real. Like, you know, I don't know. I feel like I'd be holding a grudge in that situation, because, like I said, during that entire thing, I was definitely taking Kennedy's side. Even though I love Prospect, I was like, well, you guys ain't winning. And Kennedy even made a comment, like, why are you winning now? He's like, when I managed them, they didn't win nothing, and now they're winning all these matches all of a sudden. I'm like, he's got a point. But no, just a really cool moment. So I love the promo. Like I said, the match was good on top of it, so it just kind of a thumbs up all around. Up next, we got El Ligero versus Mike Bailey. Again, these guys had separate matches previously, but due to some flight delays or weather conditions, they're thrown together. This match is really good. Once again, you can't go wrong with El Ligero, and this was the El Ligero I like. We didn't get goofy Ligero, we got real Ligero, and that's, you know. Mike Bailey, I am tremendously impressed with this guy, and I remember thinking after the Canadian qualifier, I was like, I hope we see more of him. But I was kind of worried, because I was like, he's probably stationed in Canada. He's probably going to be doing Canada more than anything else. No, like, he came over here and really surprised me, so I was really happy to see that Mike Bailey, you know, continued in WCPW. And it was a really good match. Dude, Bailey, man, I just love, you know, rapid. He had these, like, rapid-fire, like, karate kicks. He just kept, like, like, really fast in the ring. I was like, holy shit. And then, of course, he runs as they do the running the ropes thing. And, like, Ligero catches him with the Canadian Destroyer. They called it the Mexican Destroyer. Either way, flipping power or pile driver, it was awesome. However, Bailey picks up the win, and he hits him with that Shooting Star knee drop, which I think I kept hearing Bradshaw refer to as the Ultima Weapon. Either way, really cool match. Really liked it. Big thumbs up. Up next, we got Session Moth Martinez. Martina? The Martina or Martina? I think it's Martina. Session Moth Martina. She's trying to enter the building with beer. The security guard don't want her to get through. And of course, she distracts him momentarily, and she runs to the women's room. I love a lie. So I don't know. I have never seen this woman wrestle. In fact, I don't know much about her. I just know what I've read and seen and stuff like that. And so I just assumed I would probably not like this woman. I was like, she's going to be like the female Grado, and it's just going to get on my nerves pretty quickly. So I'm not going to lie, I did write her off pretty quickly, or pretty early. But we'll see how that turns around later on. The next match is a hardcore match. It is Bad Bones versus Primate. And holy shit, match of the night. This is my match of the night. I loved it. Like, every bit of this was just like, holy shit. Man, I mean, it starts off, these guys are just pounding the hell out of each other. And I mean, I like both guys. I'm a big fan of Primate. Been a big fan of Primate for, you know, for a long time. And Bad Bones just won me over early on. I just love his attitude. I just wish he'd pick up some more wins. That's the only bad thing about it. Is like, I think he's had five matches. Well, five singles matches, not technically the tag matches. But he had five single matches, and he's only won one of the five. And I'm just like, I really wish he'd pick up some more wins. But because he's awesome in these hardcore matches, and I love it. I do love the commentary on this one, too, because, once again, Primate was a client, former client. That's sticking up. That's sticking up, isn't it? Hey, that looks better. More classy. Kennedy was, you know, the client or former client. I'm not sure what the deal is right there. But, of course, we all know King Ross was... You know, he brought Primate to the Rumble. He accompanied out there to the Rumble. And then, of course, you know, we've been seeing little videos and stuff with these guys together. And so Candy's getting pissed off about that. And I like that. Because I was like, why aren't they addressing this? Like, I was wanting to address that at No Regrets. And then right after the next event was, I was like, they haven't talked about this at all. And I was like, why not? So I'm really glad that, you know, we're probably going to see something out there. And I like to see some kind of, like, I don't want to say a Ross Candy match, but I like to see these guys, like, you know, once Ross kind of has Kennedy in his corner, maybe, or sorry, once Ross has Primate as his wrestler, then maybe Kennedy will grab someone else to try to combat or something like that. I want to see something. But yeah, I really dug that. But back to the actual match, man, like outside, they kept Bad Bones kept throwing Primate into the guardrail. And like, I don't need the guardrail, dude. The guardrail will just flip up. And I'm like, dude, this is going to wipe out like an entire row of people there. How it didn't, I don't know. It's amazing that it didn't. But still, yeah, it was pretty impressive. Right there. Of course, Bad Bones did his chair spot where he takes the chairs and he kind of puts them like together and he lays them sideways so it's just fucking steel that doesn't fold on you. And of course, he's the one that took the end of that. Like, he gets dropped into that, and I was like, holy shit, that's just gotta hurt. Someone on Twitter even made a comment, he's like, I think Bad Bones just loves pain. I'm like, hey, maybe, like, maybe, because my god, he was taking most of the punishment throughout this match. They also did, you know, he kept putting the trash can, and Primate swings for defenses with the mop handle, and then, of course, they actually set up the guardrail early on. He sets the, you know, the empty side. The side there's no one over there. They pick up the guardrail, and he, I think it was Bad Bones that even set it up. He sets it up between the guardrail and the ring. So, yeah, I think this little thing right there. And later on, it does come into play as Primate. I think they're going for, like, a spear. I think it was kind of a spear, but just he didn't go through it. He just kind of knocks him into it. But either way, bends up the shit out of that guardrail. Bad Bones hits that in a bad way. Primate throws him back in there, hits him with a spear. 1, 2, 3, Primate wins. And yeah, just another one of those things where it's just like, now that Kennedy's not managing him, he's winning more now. It's just like, wow, maybe it is Kennedy. Maybe it is Kennedy. I love you, Kennedy. I'm still on your side, but what in the Little Miss Roxy? Wasn't there a storyline with Kennedy had Little Miss Roxy and then that just evaporated? Like, just gone? I don't know. Speaking of women's division, next match, it's Viper versus Session Moth Martina. And once again, as this match happened, I'm just like, man, I just want a quick squash match. Like, I do not like this Session Moth. But as the match went on, I don't know. It's infectious. It's about as infectious as the crabs I'm sure she has. I love this match. I liked her. I thought she did a really good job. She's very entertaining. And yeah. Giving it a thumbs up. Didn't think she'd win me over like that, but she did. And this match was more or less a comedy match. Like, you know, every time that Viper would try to get the upper hand on her, she was, you know, Session Moth was just doing weird things. Constantly trying to drink. At one point, she goes for like a Bronco Buster, and Viper sprays her with some deodorant or some kind of feminine spray right in the crotch, which I thought was just hilarious. Candy, during this whole... match was just hilarious. Session Moth was like grinding against him, and he's just like, oh, I need to get, I need to clean this jacket now. It was just great stuff. And it ends when Viper hits her in the face with that spray. And, like the Mickey Nookie Driver, Falcon Arrow, whatever the fuck she did. She hit her with the move. 1, 2, 3, Viper wins. Big win for Viper. So, yeah, good match. Really, I was really shocked about that. I really was. Up next, internet title match. Kenny Williams going up against Gabriel Kidd. This was a solid match, too. I really dug it. Kenny Williams getting a lot of good stuff in. And then guess what? For the third match in a row, Gabriel Kidd wins with a small package. That's his new finisher. I don't even care what anybody says. That's his new shirt. Just master of the small package. Master of the surprise roll-up. Boom. Fucking Gabriel Kidd, internet champion. I was really hoping that Kidd would shine on this a little bit more here, because I can already tell that's going to be his major storyline, which I'm cool with. Was him just more or less being the underdog champion, because like every match he goes into, he really is, he's not the favorite to win, no matter what. Even though I knew he was going to walk away with the victory here, it was just like, man, it just feels like Kenny Williams should just destroy him. And I was really hoping he would maybe man up on this one a little bit, but nah, it was pretty even back and forth, And Gabriel Kidd with a small package. I'm just like, wow, three matches in a row, small package wins. That's incredible. Like, I just made that joke last time. I'm like, he just won twice with a small package. That's his new finisher. No, three times now. We are up to three times. Small package, Gabriel Kidd, internet champion, fucking awesome. So up next, it's Joe Coffey versus Rampage. And another thing, I guess this will kind of, I'll talk about it here later. We'll get to that here in a second. Anyways, so Joe Coffey, Rampage, awesome match. These guys were just powerhousing each other. I just love that. Like, it's just like they kept like throwing everything they had at each other and they couldn't knock each other down. I thought that was a really cool moment. At one point, though, Joe Coffey goes for a springboard crossbody. He misses and lands on his knee and doesn't get back up, down. And of course, the referee goes to check on him, and of course, throws the X up, and I was like, oh, wow, like, really? But then, you never know. But I was, waiting for it, and of course, whole time, Rampage is waiting kind of patiently, and I want him to be better to leave, and then, he's like, and the trainer trying to get him out, and of course, at this point now, the crowd's buying into, because they're clapping heavily, sign of respect. Remember Doug Williams, when he, had his fall, and they kind of fucked him up? Even though he was the bad guy going in and everybody's booing him, instantly everybody's like on his side clapping. I mean, it's like, it's a bad fall. And so the same thing was happening here. And then as soon as Rampage turns back, I was like, oh, here it comes. And sure enough, Coffey sprints over to the side and just beats the shit out of Rampage. And dude, the crowd turns ugly. The biggest booze of the night was right there. And I was like, holy shit. And dude, the look on Coffey's face was just priceless. Like, he's great. He's a great heel. Like, seriously. The Prestige has been the best thing to happen to both Coffey and Hendry, in my opinion. It really added some more personality to these guys. But I love that, he just, completely embraces it. I will say he did the Travelodge card thing, but I think he did that before this. But still yet, the next thing he does, which was great, which I was like, I would have been chanting, this is awesome at this point. He does the Superman punch, and he does it exactly like Roman Reigns. He fucking cocks it and slams it to the ground. And dude, the crowd is just booing. And just the look on his face, he's just like, yep, I'm going to fucking do this. It was great. And then he hits him with his Superman punch. And I was like, yep, this is awesome right here. Like, that's how you get some heat right there. You start copying Roman Reigns' moveset, you're bound to get some heat. However, Rampage fucking fights back, beats the shit out of him, eventually hits him with the pile driver. 1, 2, 3, Rampage wins. And I was thinking at this point, I was like, why didn't Hendry try to help and interfere? Like, why didn't he? We're going to see, spoiler alert, Coffey interfere on Hendry's behalf later on. But as I was thinking that, like, at the end of the night, when I was like, oh, wow, like, why, seems kind of one-sided, I'm thinking, well, that makes sense, because Hendry, even though he's with the Prestige, at the end of the day, it's all about Hendry. It's all about Hendry. So it does make sense that, like, Hendry's not going to help Coffey at all. But yeah, he expects Coffey to help him. He's like, you better be out there and help me defend this world title. But when it's your turn, nah, I'm not going to be out there. So it just kind of adds another little letter to it. I like that. But yeah, Rampage picks up the win. Awesome. Looking really good. And clearly he is heading toward Hendry. That's where we're going to be looking at next. I'm pretty sure we're going to have a Hendry Rampage. He's working his way up the card, if you will. Making his way through the Prestige. Main event time. Martin Kirby versus Joe Hendry. Before the match, they actually showed, and they showed this on the What Culture channel anyways, but they showed the little video package that Kirby put together. And once again, they reused a clip of me and Richie Estrada from Kirby Mania in this. So it's really cool to see that again. I was like, yeah. Same clip, and I'm still just smiling. Like, that's the coolest thing ever. But yeah, so we get the main event match right here. And this match just goes, it just starts right outside. And I'm just like, wow, this is like Henry's new MO. Like, now he's just like, that's how I'm going to start all my matches. Just big brawl outside before we get in the ring. But yeah, battling all through the crowd, getting pretty crazy. One of my favorite little moments was Henry is like on the far end over here. He's down or whatever, and he's in the crowd, I mean. And Kirby goes all the way to the other side of the wall, and like, this is a big arena. That's what I'm saying. Like, whenever it has such a big arena, it definitely emphasized the small crowd. Or maybe it was a decent-sized crowd, but just looked smaller because of the big arena. Either way, and then Kirby just takes off like a head of steam. Just fucking flying, and it's like shoulder tackle, and I'm like, yes! Like, the whole time, like, that is the coolest thing ever. It's great, because Hendry counters after that, and he decides he's gonna do it. He goes all the way to the end. He has the funniest run. Like, he's a big guy. Running's not gonna be his thing. Watch his run. It's funny. It's adorable. He just kind of like, it's like me trying to run. Just kind of a little. It's watch it. But he runs, takes off running the same length. But he gets hit with a super kick. And I was just like, that's just great right there. Freaking love it. It goes up the bleachers. And of course, at one point, it looked like Kirby is gonna, or I can't remember, I think it was Kirby is gonna suplex Hendry, like, down the bleachers. I was like, dude, don't fucking do that. Like I said, I know it's weird, but like, I'm just like, man, it's dangerous. This guy probably deserves it. Character deserves it. But nope, Hendry counters out, and they eventually get back in the ring. Referee goes down, and of course, that brings out Coffee. He takes the title, and he clubs Liguero with it. 1, 2, 3. Joe Hendry retains the title. Kirby once again screwed out of the thing. And then, of course, after the match, they start beating him down. And, of course, that brings out Rampage, who clears the ring, and they, you know, get out. However, guess who comes back? Adam Blompier. He was here all along after all. Comes out, and, of course, he's extremely pissed off, and he makes a match, a last man standing street fight at Fight Back between Kirby and Hendry. And If any member of the Prestige interferes in that, he's just going to strip the title of Hendry and hand it to Kirby. So the match is set up. And I like that. I really did. Because I'm like, but I still think Hendry's going to hang on to it. Because once again, yeah, remember, Last Man Standing, that's pretty much how he won the first time. Like, he just beat the shit out of Kirby until there was nothing left. Like, there was nothing left of Kirby. And he's just like, eh. Win. So I was like, this is definitely favoring Hendry more. But anything goes, and Kirby knows that, so maybe he'll come in with a little extra firepower. And once again, there is no stipulation that no one else can interfere. I think that's how Hendry's probably going to win it, maybe, is he'll have someone other than a Prestige member interfere. But, you know, I'm thinking to myself, I'm a kayfabe mark. Maybe, you know, Kirby will hire somebody or have Rampage or everybody else that the Prestige has screwed over thus far and attack him and take the title back. But either way, looking forward to it either way. So, yeah, Fight Back. It'll be awesome. And so that was Hendry Mania. I enjoyed it. I really did. Once again, I mean, there's a few things here and there, but overall, I felt like it was an enjoyable 2.5 hours. And I was even dead tired. That's another thing. I was afraid, like, I was like, man, this may affect my review because it's like, once again, it was just really late at night, and I was just like, man, I really hope I don't just get groggy or fall asleep or be grumpy because I'm tired. And no, I mean, like, literally, it was still enjoyable. Like, even tired. So, I mean, I'm sure if I was more coherently awake, I'd be like, yeah, best event ever. No, I really enjoyed Hendry Mania. Like I said, a few things I would have probably done a little differently. I wish I would have seen a little bit more Prestige out there. And I understand, I'm guessing, like, BT Gunn and Travis Banks were probably busy doing other things, which I would incorporate that into the story. I would literally talk about how I'm sent my soldiers out to spread the word Prestige into other territories, other companies. Why not? You know, I mean, just keep it relevant, explain the absence. And at the same time, I would have had him and Coffee, do more shit during Hendry Mania. Like, it's his show, right? Like, he should definitely be like, every time they kept chanting, this is awesome. I just remember, he did that entire rant about how he's just sick of the crowd being stupid. He wants, you should respect wrestling like I do. And so I was really wanting him to see him just kind of cut loose, but we didn't get that, unfortunately. But like I said, all in all, I said, decent women's match, good internet title match, the tag match was really good. And like I said, even my 8th ranked match, the Drake versus Shaw Samuels, double S is throwing me off. It was enjoyable. And once again, I just loved the way it ended. Like, I was like, yeah, bash him with that pipe. Like, seriously, Drake needs to win more. It's all right. He'll bash him in the head with a wrench, and we'll be good to go. And then, of course, Kennedy, he killed it on commentary. Like, I was a little nervous. Like, oh, man, how's this going to be? No, he did really good. Like, honestly, like, I would not be sad if he kept coming back. Like, it's not bad at all. So, yeah. Overall, really good stuff right here. Guys, let me know what you thought of Henry Mania. Just an epic. Always again. It is kind of funny because we just lost Loaded. They just yanked all the Loaded. But it's like we got like three major events. Like we got the Canadian qualifier and Henry Mania this weekend. Next weekend's Fight Back. It's just like, man, we have no Loaded, but we got a lot of great action coming our way. So, hey, I'm looking forward to it. It's awesome. So let me know what you guys thought about the event in the comment section down below. Tune in later on today. I'll be doing my top 10. Got some changes. We got some changes. So, yeah, be ready for that. And, yeah, that's all I got. Guys, thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to share and subscribe if you haven't already. Show that video that thumb and love. And, of course, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, all that good stuff. I'm constantly doing just different shit on all of them. All those links are down below. And, yeah, that's all I got. Guys, once again, thank you. Thank you for watching. Till next time.